Hi everyone, this is Tulika from Edoxa Transforming Schools and I'm here to talk about small group instructions. So a lot of times I get this kind of worries from the teachers that they have been doing everything they could but the class result is not improving. The growth of the students is not phenomenal. And so every time they ask me this question, I ask them, what are the things that you have done? And they every time, we talk about a specific topic and they'll be like, well, I taught this concept in the whole class group. And then I took an assessment and then I saw that the results are still the same. And then I retaught the whole class and the results are still the same. So here is my takeaway from this. When you are reteaching the concept to the whole class, basically you're not doing anything new. You are just doing the same thing over and over again. So if one thing is not working the first time, the second time, then repeatedly doing it will not give you any results. And that's when I ask them to implement small group instructions in their class. So small group instructions are instructions that usually follows the whole class instruction. So basically you taught a concept or topic or a lesson, and then once you have taught it, you give an assessment to the students and see where they are. So when you see the data, you will find that there are students who have shown growth, who have shown the understanding about the concept. There is this group of students who have shown the mastery, and then there is another group of students who are still struggling and they have no clue about the concept. So this data, this meaningful data, drives your instruction from whole class to small class, small group. So why we need to do the small group? A lot of teachers are so scared when I first introduce them that this is something you can try, do this way, and they are, very scared. Don't be scared, don't freak out, because I was there at your place. I had been the same, I have been in your shoes. When I was in the US and my then principal, Ms. Norwood, asked me to, implement small groups, I was freaking out. Because I'm a more control person, I control my class, my classroom management is my strength, and I was scared that doing small groups, giving students some flexibility, ownership may create a chaos, because what if the students are not in control, because I'm working with a small group and rest of the groups are working on their own. So I always was scared and I would try, but I would not try and give my 100% and I would always fail. And so eventually when I actually got a training on it, I was given coaching on it, and when I started implementing, taking one step at a time, guess what? That was a huge change in my teaching style. And then once I started implementing, it was like every 2 days, 3 days, or after every whole class instruction, I will have a small group. Because guess what? It takes away my work from the shoulder, because now students are taking ownership. They are being accountable for their own learning. So it's not only helping me, but it's also helping students to own what they understand and courageous enough to tell the teacher that you don't understand this concept. So you see how students become more accountable. And now the question comes, what are the benefits? So the benefits of small group, the very first benefit is that the teacher-student ratio reduces. A teacher teaching to 30 students to a teacher teaching to 4, 5 or maybe max 6 students at a time. So you see, the teacher-student, when the teacher-student ratio reduces, then the chances are that, you will see growth in the students' learning. The second benefit is the instruction is more individualized, it's personalized. Because once you know the data, you know which students are struggling, you know which students have already mastered the concepts, you don't have to reteach the concept to that student who has already mastered. So you are teaching only the students who are struggling. Or maybe sometimes you are teaching to the students who have already mastered because you want to give them some challenges. And so you kind of very quick, deal with the higher group, you give them some prompts, some challenging exercises or real life application, and then you switch to your struggling group where you are one-on-one with them, helping them to overcome their struggle. The second benefit is that you are able to give frequent feedback. Trust me, this had been one of my challenges when I was teaching, that no matter how much I think and try to give feedback to most of my students, if not 100%, I would always end up looking at the data and I was like, oh, I was only able to reach 60% of the students, or sometimes even 50% of the students when it comes to give feedback. whereas in small group, I'm able to give feedback to almost everybody, you know, because the groups are rotating. I'm seeing everybody for a few, maybe 15 to 20 minutes based on how long the classes are. And sometimes I'm spending more time with the students who actually need more help or assistance. And so that's a beauty that, you know, you get opportunity, teachers get opportunity to give real-time feedback. Now the major aspect is how to implement. What are the things that a teacher should, you know, keep in mind before implementing? So the very first thing that every teacher should take care of is classroom expectations and routines. So this is also kind of a routine procedure. So teacher needs to implement it as a practice. So something that you wanna, you know, let the students know that, you know, in a small group, these are the expectations, these are set norms, this is how you're gonna work in small group, and what to do when the teacher is not available, or the teacher is busy with another group and you need immediate help. What are the sign languages that you can use? So in my class, during the small group, I had a lot of sign languages. That way I don't have to stop teaching or I'm not being interrupted. They just show me the sign language. If I'm okay with that, I show them thumbs up. If I think like this is not the right time, I just show them the thumbs down. Whether it's asking for help, restroom, water, switching, or helping, taking help from anybody, anything. So based on, you know, the classroom situation, I show them thumbs up or thumbs down, which really helps to reduce those conversations during the teaching. So it's really essential that teachers practice expectations. The second thing to be taken care of is, you know, the data. It's really essential that you do not randomly group the students, but you group the students based on the data. The reason I'm saying it is because not necessarily the group who is, you know, your gifted group or your high achiever are always high achiever. Maybe they are a concept that they are still struggling, so they don't have to be in that group. Or maybe your lower group, there are concepts that they think easier, one or two of them already know it or have mastered it. They should not be in that group all the time. So the group should be as per the current data, not based on your opinion. Oh, I know he might have understood. Oh, I know he could have not, you know, got it. No personal judgment should be here, only data. Data drives your instruction. So it's really essential to take data into consideration. And the third part is to have patience. You know, it's not gonna be perfect the very first time, not gonna be okay the second time, but guess what, with practice and your students getting used to with it, the things gonna fall into place automatically. If you want a specific you know, information, you want any template, you want me to, you know, have a workshop for you or for your school or any trainings, feel free to contact me. You can connect me through my email, that is samuel.tuleka@gmail.com, or you can also comment in the comment section. And I hope you like this video. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye-bye.